السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر. لا إله إلا الله. الله أكبر الله أكبر ولله الحمد. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأصلي وأسلم على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، نبينا وحبيبنا وقرة أعيننا محمد بن عبد الله، عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم، أما بعد. All praise and thanks be to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is our creator, sustainer, nourisher, protector and curer. We ask Allah the Almighty to shower His choicest of blessings and salutations upon our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family members, his companions and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. My dear respected elders, brothers and sisters in Islam, Alhamdulillah, the day of Eid is upon us. All praise and thanks be to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The amazing month of Ramadan, the beautiful and noble month of Ramadan, just whizzed past us so fast. Allahu Akbar. This Ramadan of 1435 Hijri just whizzed past us. I'm sure all of us would attest to that, that it is as if it just began and then before you know it, the month of Ramadan is gone. And these are from the signs of the day of Qiyamah. Scholars, rahimahumullah, they explain that in terms of the minor signs of the day of Qiyamah, most of the minor signs of the day of Qiyamah have already taken place. Most of them, Allahu Akbar. There are just a few more remaining from the minor signs of the day of Qiyamah, after which the major signs of the day of Qiyamah will start to take place. And as we have been informed by our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and please remember salawat whenever I mention his beautiful name, he is reported to have said along the lines of these words that even if one of the major signs of the day of Qiyamah were to take place, even if one, the remaining would start occurring consecutively one after the other, just as how if a necklace with beads, if it were to break, just as how the pearls or the beads would fall one after the other at a very rapid pace, the major signs of the day of Qiyamah would start to occur one after the other at a very rapid pace. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive our sins, and may He the Almighty ease the questioning upon us. Let us prepare to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nevertheless, the few minutes that I have with you all today on this blessed day, I wish to touch on a short message that I wish to pass on to you all, and that is in regard to maintaining the momentum even after the month of Ramadan. Maintaining the momentum even after the month of Ramadan. Ali radiallahu an is reported to have said very wise words. He is reported to have said, How I wish that I could identify the individual who benefited from the month of Ramadan. Allahu Akbar. How I wish that I could identify the individual whose Ramadan has been accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so that I can congratulate that individual. Allahu Akbar. And likewise, how I wish that I could identify the individual who has been deprived of the blessings of the month of Ramadan. How I wish I could identify the individual whose Ramadan has been rejected by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so that I can offer my sympathies to him. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from those whose Ramadan has been accepted by Him the Almighty. Scholars rahimahumullah, they elaborate that it is from the signs, alamatul qubuliyya, in other words, the signs of the acceptance of one's Ramadan. If an individual sees himself persisting in those good deeds that he was busy with in the month of Ramadan, say if he used to make his salah on time in the month of Ramadan, if he used to dedicate a portion for the daily recitation from the noble Quran, and likewise if he used to ponder on the words of our powerful maker, if he used to involve himself in very good acts and deeds such as charitable deeds, charitable projects, and etc., if he were to find himself persisting in those deeds even after the month of Ramadan, those same deeds, as long as he does not remove those garbs of piety, those garbs of righteousness, and goes back to his old ways, if he or she finds himself persisting in those good deeds, Allahu Akbar, then it is upon him. He can identify that indeed his Ramadan, this is one of the signs that his Ramadan has been accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this brings about the concept of istiqamah, which is extremely, extremely important. Istiqamah, in other words, is steadfastness. Being steadfast on the right path. In other words, persisting in doing what is good. There's no point in just turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, donning the garbs of piety and righteousness just for the month of Ramadan, and the minute the month of Ramadan leaves us, to go back to our old ways. This is not from tawbah, this is not turning over a new leaf, and indeed this is something that angers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because we are making a mockery out of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is indeed an encompassing ocean. We are enveloped in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Such is the mercy of our beloved maker. And that mercy is not something that we should take as a joke. Allahu Akbar. Once Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, may my mother, my father and myself be ransomed for him, he was coming back after an expedition, after a particular battle with the Sahaba, Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in. They were victorious, of course, and they had taken a few captives. And they were coming back, and whilst they were returning, there was a scene which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam was witnessing, and that was a mother who was taken captive. She was searching, because this is natural after a battle, captives are taken. She was searching for her child that she had lost during the battle. She was searching for her child that she had lost during the battle. And she was so worried, she was so upset, she was going around looking for her child. She was carrying one child, looking at the child closely whether it was her child or not, and then placing the child on the ground. She was so upset, she was searching, she was very upset. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he looks at her and then looks at the Sahaba, Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in. And the minute this lady identified her child, you know, relief washed over her face, and she was hugging the child, looking at the child with so much of love and so much of care. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked the Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in. The narration goes along the lines of these words: oh my companions, you see this woman? You see this woman? Look at how much love she has for her child. Do you think that she would throw that child of hers into a blazing fire? Do you think that she would throw that child of hers, which she is looking with so much of love, so much of care, do you think that she would throw that child of hers into a blazing fire? The Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in were amazed. They were so surprised. They said, no ya Rasulullah, we cannot imagine this mother who loves her child so much. The signs of love, signs of care is so visible on her face. She would never throw her child into a blazing fire. Then our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said some amazing words, my dear respected elders, brothers and sisters in Islam. He says, wallahi, wallahi, by Allah, Allah is more forgiving and more merciful towards His slaves than that mother towards her child. Allahu Akbar. This is how merciful Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. Let us not lose hope. Let us not despair in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Losing hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is indeed an evil crime. It is a sin to lose hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hope and fear. Al-raja wa والخوف are the two wings of a believer. Hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are the two wings of a believer that a believer uses to fly unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So let us strike a beautiful balance between hope and fear, resulting in us being able to fly like birds towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, coming back to istiqamah. Istiqamah is something that we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in every single prayer of ours. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should guide us onto the straight path and keep us steadfast on the straight path. We recite Surah Al-Fatiha in every single prayer, multiple times. اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الضَّالِّينَ اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ مستقيم, استقامة, stems from the same root. Ya Allah, guide us onto the straight path. Guide us onto the straight path. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala every single day, asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us on the straight path. Therefore, let us work. Let us work towards persisting in those good deeds that we were involved in the month of Ramadan. All of us, no doubt, would have intended to turn over a new leaf, to leave all of those evil ways. We would have discarded those garbs of evil and those garbs of sin. Let us not even think of going back to those evil deeds, my dear respected elders, brothers and sisters in Islam. May Allah the Almighty forgive all of our sins, and may He accept the fasting that we fasted in the month of Ramadan for Him, and may He help us to be steadfast on those good deeds, and may He help us to turn towards Him before it's too late. In the last few minutes that I've got, I would like to touch on a few sunnahs from the day of Eid. Number one, starting off with, and I'll wrap it off with the description of the salah just before we make the salah. Number one is in regard to ghusl, in regard to bathing before we come for Salatul Eid. Most of the scholars, rahimahumullah, and likewise our Salafun al-Salih, our pious predecessors, have reported that it is very much commendable or preferable that an individual takes a bath before he comes for the Eid prayer. It is very recommended that an individual takes a bath before he comes to the Eid prayer, just as how is the case with all congregational ibadah in terms of our deen, so that we do not harm our brothers, our neighbors next to us with our offensive orders perhaps. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us all to act upon the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The next great sunnah in terms of the day of Eid is that an individual, especially Eid al-Fitr, to dispel any doubts that an individual may be fasting on the day of Eid, it is from the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to consume something before heading for Salatul Eid, preferably dates. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to have an odd number of dates before heading for Salatul Eid. In the case of Eid al-Fitr. But in the case of Eid al-Adha, he used to eat, and that used to be from the animal that he sacrificed for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It would be after the Salatul Eid. But in terms of Eid al-Fitr, it used to be generally before Salatul Eid. So it is upon us to have something, and mashallah, I see people distributing dates out in the front. We are reviving the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah the Almighty reward the brothers who are involved in regard to that. The next sunnah, my dear respected elders, brothers and sisters in Islam, is to involve oneself in takbir. This is something at times many of us, including myself, illama rahimallah, are forgetting. This is not something that we should forget. The Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'in, from the night of Eid, they used to make excessive takbir of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because he himself states in the noble Quran, وَلِتُكْمِلُوا الْعِدَّةَ وَلِتُكَبِّرُوا اللَّهَ عَلَى مَا هَدَاكُمْ وَلَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. And Allah subhanahu subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to complete the specified number of days, i.e. the month of Ramadan. وَلِتُكَبِّرُ اللَّهِ And afterwards you should magnify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by making takbir. وَلِتُكَبِّرُ اللَّهَ عَلَى مَا هَدَاكُمْ Upon that which He has guided you all towards. وَلَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ And so that you will be grateful unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So let us make excessive takbir. In terms of Eid al-Fitr, it's from the night of Eid until the Imam comes for Salatul Eid. You should make excessive takbir. In terms of Eid al-Adha, in terms of the Hajj festival, it is from the night of Eid until the last 3 days, until the sunset of the last 3 days of Ayyam al-Tashriq. We should make excessive takbir of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are many forms of making takbir, which I'm sure most of us are aware. Let us make takbir of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, magnifying Him and glorifying Him. The next in line is offering congratulations to one another. There are few brothers who are in the doubt whether it is a bid'ah to say Eid Mubarak, and because you have, these days you have various innovations going around. So this, my dear respected elders, brothers and sisters in Islam, is not an innovation. It has been reported from the Sahaba, Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'in, and our Salafun as-Salih, that they used to congratulate one another using different wording, such as Eid Mubarak, or Taqabbalallahu minna wa minkum kulla amin wa antum bi khair. So the scholars, rahimahumullah, they explain that there is no harm in you congratulating one another on the day of Eid, as long as there aren't any sinful words involved in your congratulations. So there is no harm at all in congratulating one another. The next in line, my dear respected elders, brothers and sisters in Islam, is embracing one another. Embracing one another. It is a gesture, a sign of love, unity, brotherhood. So at times, some brothers are in doubt perhaps as to, is it permissible to embrace one another once, twice, thrice, four times, five times, where you embrace one on this side and the other side. There is no issue at all. Scholars, rahimahumullah, explain, in accordance to different localities, different areas, different customs and rituals, you can greet one another. For example, if you take in the Arab lands, they touch their cheeks on one another, they kiss one another. It depends on the location where we are from. What is regarded as the norm, we follow that, there is no issue at all. But if a particular brother feels uncomfortable with someone hugging him three times, four times, he can politely decline or refuse and suffice himself with one hug. After all, it is a gesture of love, brotherhood and unity. Next in line, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, is the Eid prayer, which is of utmost importance, as we will be praying in another few minutes. So we will start off with a quick description in a synopsis. The Eid prayer, it begins with your, this is one of the biggest sunnahs of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Some of the scholars, rahimahumullah, of the opinion that it is a sunnah mu'akkada, an emphasized sunnah, and others are of the opinion that it is an obligation upon us. Nevertheless, it starts off with niyyah. I hope you are with me. Please focus, as this will be the description of the salah we will be praying in another few minutes. Starting off with niyyah, it is important that we intend, because innamal a'malu bin niyyat, actions are but by intention. So it is upon us to intend that we are praying. For example, if it is Salatul Eid al-Fitr for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, whether we should articulate the niyyah or not, scholars have differed in regard to this. Know for a fact that some scholars, rahimahumullah, have even gone to the extent to state that articulating or pronouncing your niyyah is considered an innovation. So let us strike a balance, because it hasn't been reported from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he or the Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'in used to articulate the niyyah. Because after all, the place of the niyyah is one's heart. So let us intend using our hearts, intend that we are going to pray Salatul Eid for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Salatul Eid is a two-unit prayer. Salatul Eid is a two-unit prayer, in other words, two raka'at. In the first raka'ah, there will be seven takbirs. There will be seven takbirs where one will raise their hands and say Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Seven takbirs. So now, whether this includes the takbiratul ihram or not, what is the takbiratul ihram? The takbiratul ihram is the first takbir the imam ties, Allahu Akbar. Whether it includes that or not, it's a broad matter, there is nothing to dispute about it. Whether if it includes the takbiratul ihram, then it will be the takbiratul ihram and then six takbirs, or else it will be the takbiratul ihram and another seven takbirs. Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah, he states that it is takbiratul ihram and then another seven takbirs, totaling it to eight takbirs. And the other scholars rahimahullah, such as Imam Ahmad rahimahullah and others, say that with takbiratul ihram, another six, totaling it up to seven. So whether it be seven or eight, the matter is broad, there is nothing to worry. There's no harm in either following one of the two opinions. So we make six or seven takbirs after the takbiratul ihram, and each takbir, the imam should take some time. You don't go very fast, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, but rather give a tiny pause in the middle, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. And should you recite anything in between these takbirs, nothing has been reported from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So therefore we follow him by keeping quiet. And also we should raise our hands for each takbir. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. We should raise our hands for each takbir. And after the seven takbirs in the first rak'ah, or eight takbirs with the takbiratul ihram, the imam will recite Suratul Fatiha, and after Suratul Fatiha, he will recite Suratul A'la, which is from the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And there is no harm in reciting any other surah, but it is best to stick to the sunnah of our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now the second rak'ah, there will be five takbirs. There is no takbiratul ihram in the second rak'ah. So there will be five takbirs and only five takbirs. There is no difference of opinion there. There will be five takbirs in total, in which nothing should be recited in the middle, but we should just keep quiet. And after the five takbirs, Suratul Fatiha and another surah will be recited. And the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is to recite Suratul Ghashiya or Suratul Qamar. First rak'ah, Suratul A'la and Surah Qaf. Second rak'ah, it will be either Suratul Ghashiya or Suratul Qamar. So it is upon the imam to stick to the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because if we follow the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, no doubt we are all going to be rewarded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for following the most beloved of his creation. So having said that, I think we will start the salah in a minute or two. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive all of our sins. May He the Almighty accept our good deeds. And may He the Almighty bless us so that we see more Ramadan in our lives. And may He the Almighty help us to remain steadfast in all of those good deeds that we were busy in the month of Ramadan. And just as how He united us here this morning on this beautiful day of Eid, may He the Almighty Azza wa Jal unite all of us in the gardens of Jannah with our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ameen wa akhir da'waya and alhamdulillah.